Good evening.
Good evening to you too.
Thank you. Today we'll be talking about spirit, about soul, about the importance of the soul and the contribution to the creation. A huge subject. And we will be talking, of course, in general about the so-called spiritual layer or spiritual body, where all the spirits reside, and from where, as you can see in the existential model, the soul originates. Throughout our discussion, I will repeat again and again that it is the soul who is thinking, and that's a great responsibility. It is the thinking process is the privilege of the soul itself. It may appear in the actual materialization, but over there it appears as an effect, as a result of what the spirit, which is throughout, is contributing to the actual creation. So, no soul, no thinking. And everywhere you see thinking, you have to always look for spirit, because it is the soul who is thinking. It's very, very important. Now, the fact that it is the soul that is thinking, that means that it is capable to make decisions, which tells us right away that all the decision is made by the spirit. To phrase it in terms of the actual cosmic laws, since one, as you know, one of the cosmic laws is the free will expression, that tells us right away that the free will is determined and is expressed by the spirit. So anything that happens, all the decisions made, all the choices are done by the spirit. Very important conclusion. Try to see the evidence in my arguments as I move along. Now, we can start right away talking about that, but it's a good idea to start in a way that we can connect what we already have told in the last presentation, which, as you remember, it was referring to consciousness or the consciousness zone model. At that time, we mentioned a lot of things about consciousness. Here is the consciousness zone model, which is another energetic model. We will not talk about that too much today, but we will be talking about the fact that the consciousness, it is expressed by the spirit, since the spirit is which is thinking and decides. So we will start from the point where we'll see how the spirit is connected to the actual mental body, where the consciousness is the most important thing. Now, if we look at this diagram, which is the continuation, I didn't use it in our discussion during the last presentation, because I prefer to use it in this one. It's sort of a summation of the previous presentation about consciousness. The consciousness is utilized by the spiritual entities, who are entities made out of spirit. These are the inhabitants of the spiritual component. Don't forget that our soul is a spiritual entity. Remember, soul is part of a spiritual entity that has been formed and is dedicated to our existence. It is actually the inhabitant, it is the master of our existence. The soul is what makes us be alive. Not that our physical body doesn't have a connection with the spirit, it has its own soul. But once the our soul goes away, our body drops down like a bag of sack, like a sack of potatoes, okay, like a bag. The body is still alive, but it is missing that whisper of God's existence, this green light of associating the spirit with this specific experience known as lifespan, where the physical body is used as a vehicle of expression. But without the soul, the physical body appears to be dead. The definition of death is just that, that the soul, for some reason, does not carry on controlling the physical body, is leaving the physical body. And that implies death. It appears to be death, okay? The physical body is still alive, as you know, but the point is that it won't be alive forever, because right after that there is not any reason for it to be alive forever, okay? So gradually dies, and the death occurs when the soul, for some reason, first of all, has ended up the utilization of the physical body. It had enough, it goes, okay? It succeeded its purpose, it goes. Something happened and changed its mind, it goes. This is one way when the soul is leaving, is abandoning the physical body. The other way is when the physical body cannot anymore carry on its obligation of providing a vehicle of expression for the soul, and a vital organ shuts down. If, for example, we have a heart attack and the heart ceases to function properly, that means that there is no more blood going to the physical body, and the soul, upon its effort to fails upon its effort to utilize the physical body, and realizes that the game is over. So it moves, and when it moves, it always goes back to where it started, which is the residence that it occupies into the spiritual layer, up there, within the spiritual body. That's where it returns. This is a good opportunity. It will take us less than 2 minutes, but it will help you connect the models together. So I will go to the actual materialization model, and I will point out to you that just above the consciousness, which is the top of the mental or cognitive layer, just above the consciousness and at the end of the spiritual layer, we have the so-called etheric zone. An etheric zone is where our souls originate. We are etheric beings. We are not the only etheric beings. The examples I've given you when I was explaining this reality of the etheric zone is that the angels are also etheric existences. Okay? So we are like the angels. The difference is that the angels who are like us, they have similar consciousness and so forth, they are not interested anymore to materialize into the physical world. They are not preoccupied with these things, whereas we are preoccupied and we are carrying on taking other physical bodies in a process of reincarnation through which we carry on our effort to become better, to learn more, to extend our consciousness. Okay? So, the etheric zone is where our soul originates. In terms of the ancient Buddhist philosophy, this means that for us the etheric zone is our bardo. Bardo is a state of residence for the spirit. It's a state of residence. So that's where we're coming from. Now, as you notice, there is a very close relationship between our bardo, which is the etheric, and our consciousness, which corresponds to the grand total of our personal values, on the basis of which our spirit acts. Our personal values are the ones that allow this to the spirit to utilize its thinking power, make decisions, express free will, and therefore create all kinds of scenario or participating scenario, whereas and every other participant is given an opportunity to learn and extend further its consciousness. Keep in mind that today's presentation, number 5 presentation, is very important because it is the end of my theory, which tries to see consciousness as a key concept of the creational process. And today you will be able to see all of these factors, the actual physicality, the corresponding emotional or astral body known as double, the thinking process, and the spiritual components are merged together and cooperate and give us the opportunity to understand how the creation works and what kind of wisdom is behind for this kind of individual existences, yet very clear way that all of these 4 bodies, these 4 entities, are in a co-creational and cooperative mode and give us the wonderful feeling of life, as complex as it appears to be. I don't put a point here, but I'm just a question mark. I put a colon because I would like to make sure that you understand that there is continuation in this kind of thing. And this continuation can only be understood if you mature enough in your thinking so that you ask the right questions. See how many questions I have asked the last moment. Question, 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 question. All of these questions require answers. Trying to get an answer, you give yourself the opportunity to extend your thinking, namely your consciousness, open up your horizons, and in trying to find answers, you achieve the much desired expansion of consciousness, which is actually is the one that becomes the cause of this effort known as life opportunity. So, the question we have to address right now is that, yes, we know that consciousness is utilized by spiritual entities and characterized spiritual entities. How can we really put some kind of logic behind that? Without logic, we don't have what I claim a metaphysical form of science, which I claim that metaphysics is. So we have to put some logic behind. In the last presentation, we talked about dimensions. Dimensions is another name for the consciousness zones that are part of the spiritual entity over there. And you will remember that we had these zones were the following seven. Number seven was God. All that is. Everything. Everything is God. The whole creation is the result of God's wisdom, God's intervention into the life. It is a divine plan that we are playing with, and we strive to understand it. While we try to understand it, we extend our spirituality. And we extend our spirituality because we expand our consciousness. So you see how these concepts are merged together. Expanding consciousness extends spirituality and you approach your creator. You learn more about the divine plan. That's what we are doing. But not everybody understands that. But that's what we are doing. But unless you ask the appropriate questions, we don't reach to this conclusion. You stop anywhere, you think that your effort, and that's the end of it. For example, there are plenty of creations which are narcissistic. They are creations that they are occupied with the physical body and the pleasure of the senses that all of us really have tasted, and depending on our level of expansion, we may be feel that this is important enough to stop and say that's the purpose of life, pleasure, power, okay, finances, and all of them, they are just factors of what really we can achieve. Or see the reality, which is the cause of the process. Because as it happens, as it is formulated, as it's shaped in the causal planes, which in the existential body model are clearly set, a spiritual layer, cognitive layer, an emotional or astral layer.